You're doing great today. I want to talk about something that seems to be very different from what we discussed in the last set of videos, and it's area. And my first question to you, area, is that even a calculus idea? You know, area is just based on certain equations, right? The area of a rectangle is length times width. The area of a circle is pi r squared. But what about area under a curve? Now, I want to leave that question just hanging for now and completely shift gears and talk about some brand new notation that we're going to need to discuss area. And this is called sigma notation. And it's just a convenient notation for adding a sequence of values. So a sequence being a list of numbers. And what we're going to do is add that list of numbers together. And so if you'll notice, you have this sigma shape, the Greek letter. And at the bottom, you'll see n equals some number, okay? And at the top, you'll see a number, or it might just say n. And so here's what we do. You start with the bottom number, and you plug it into the particular expression right there, and you plug it into I. So if I plug 1 in there, that's where the A1 comes from. And then I go to the next integer line and plug 2 in there. Then I plug 3 in there, and then I plug 4 in there, and I go all the way until the top number. In this case, it just happens to be n. If it were 4, I would stop at 4. If there was a 10 up there, I would stop at 10. But this says n, so it just keeps going all the way until we get to n, and you add all those values together. Now, the I is called the index of summation. So again, that's your index. That's what's being plugged in by these numbers that we begin with at the bottom, okay? A sub I, what we have here, is called the ith term, or the ith term. Sounds weird. But anyway, that's just when you plug in those values, okay? So that's the ith term. 1, or whatever number is at the bottom here, is called the lower bound of summation, whereas the n at the top is called the upper bound of summation. And so this is just some definitions. What I would like to do next is a few problems where we use this notation so we can really get used to what in the world is going on here. Okay, so this is my first example. Now we've got I equals 1, so 1 is our lower bound, all the way up to 4. And then notice where we're plugging these values in, right here into I. So if I write that out, again, I start with the lowest number, I plug it in here, so it's 1. And then the next number in line, integer, I plug it in, is 2. And remember, we add in between. That's what the sigma notation means, is we add in between. Then I plug in 3, and then I plug in 4. I don't go past that, because that is my upper bound. Okay, and then we just add it together. So 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, and finally 6 plus 4 is 10. So the sum of I equals 1 to 4 of just I is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, which is equivalent to 10. So see, it's that simple. Now, let me show you one that's just ever so slightly more complicated, but nothing harder, okay? Now notice our lower bound of summation is 2. So this time we start plugging 2 in for our I, and we do that until we get to 5. So again, I start at 2, so that's going to be 2 minus 1, okay, plus, always add in between, then the next integer would be 3, so 3 minus 1, plus the next integer in line is 4, so 4 minus 1, and then all the way to 5 minus 1. Now again, 5 was our upper bound at the top, 2 was our lower bound, so it should start with 2, and you plug in every integer in between, and again, you add whatever that value is right there over and over and over again. And then you just simplify. So 2 minus 1 is 1, plus 3 minus 1 is 2, plus 4 minus 1 is 3, plus 5 minus 1 is 4. I add those values together. 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, 6 plus 4 also happens to be 10. I don't give you the impression that every answer is 10. It is not, but the first two we did was 10. Now I say it's worth pausing for a minute just to make sure you can do this problem. So hopefully you got this one. So again, let's look, our lower bound is 1. So I begin plugging in 1. Notice I change letters on you, which is perfectly fine. Our index is a J this time, okay? And it says start J equals 1, and you go all the way to 4. So when I plug 1 into my J, I have 1 squared, plus always add in between, and I plug my next integer, which is 2, and my next integer, which is 3, and my next integer, which is 4. But I don't go past 4 because that is my upper bound of my summation. And now you just do the math. 1 squared is 1, 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, and then I add those values together. 1 plus 4 is 5, 5 plus 9 is 14, and 14 plus 16 gives me 30. Yay, we got a different answer than 10 that time. Okay, so they just get slightly more complicated to look at, but notice my index is K. We're calling it K this time. It's perfectly okay. The lower bound is 1, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to begin plugging in 1 for what? For K, right? Not this n value that's right here, but for K only, because that's my index is K. And I start at 1 and I stop at n. So that might feel a little odd, but we can do this. Okay, so n is not my index. That remains n times 1 to the third minus 1. Plus n, now I'm at my next integer, so that's going to be 2 to the third minus 1, plus n, next in line is 3 to the third minus 1. Well, where do we stop? Well, we stop at n. I'm going to put plus dot dot dot, the n that's in front, and then it's n to the third minus 1. Then you question how much you need to simplify. We could simplify this a little bit, right? You know 1 to the third is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0, n times 0 is 0. That first term is just 0. Plus 2 to the third is 8, 8 minus 1 is 7, that would be 7n. Plus 3 to the third is 27, 27 minus 1 is 26, so that's 26n. Plus, but then that pattern continues, to the third minus 1. So we can't actually get a sum on this because we don't know where we're stopping it in, but we don't actually know the value. So maybe I simplified it as much as I could. Actually, and it's probably nothing wrong with leaving that first result there since we can't simplify the end for now anyway. Now this notation might look a little bit odd. This is f of x sub I, so notice your index is I. It's right there, so that's what we're in our index over here listed as I. So I'm going to start plugging in 1, and I'm going to stop at n, and I'm plugging those values into I. So if I write that out, it's going to be f of x sub 1 times delta x plus f of x sub 2 times delta x plus f of x sub 3 times delta x, and that pattern continues all the way till we get to the upper bound, which is just going to be f of x sub n times delta x. Can't take it any farther than that. That's it. Okay, now why did I give you a weird looking problem like that? Because that's actually the notation we're going to see a lot when we do our problems involving area. So next, I have four really important theorems for you. When we do our area problems, which I promise are coming up soon, you're going to have to use these formulas. So the first one's going to be that I've got listed here is pretty intuitive. Now, if you'll notice, this is just when I use Word, but notice it has I equals 1 to N, but now it's moved on the side. Y'all, that actually doesn't mean anything different than I is equal to 1 to N of C, okay? And what that means is you start with the lower bound 1 and you plug it in. Well, then if you notice there's no I here to plug it in, it's almost like a constant function. Your answer is just C. and then you plug in 2 and your answer is just C, and then you plug in 3 and your answer is just C, and then you plug in 4 and your answer is just C. By now you got it. Now how far do you go with it? Well, till you get to N. So my question to you is, how many C's is that? If you do that N times, well, that's N C's. So that's N C. So that formula written right there, summed up, is fairly intuitive, right? Because you just have N of these C's written out, because there's actually no place that you're gonna plug in that value. But that's how many times you do it, is N times. So anytime you add a number over and over again, that many times, it's just that times that number. Now here's a second formula for you. So notice again the index of integration, and if I write this out how it really should look, it's I equals 1 to n of I. So if you think about what that is, we first plug 1 into the I and you get 1, plus then the next value is 2, and then the next value is 3, all the way until we get to the upper bound up here, and it gives you n. So that's what I have written right there. Now, again, this is not the intuitive part, but if you add 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7, all the way until you get to some particular value, maybe n, maybe you don't know the value, then the formula for calculating that sum is n times n plus 1 over 2. Again, I know that's not intuitive. You might think, how in the world did they come up with that? And that's a different story, but that is the formula for it. Like if we were going to calculate, let me do this in a different color. If we were going to calculate the sum of I is equal to 1 to 35, right? That'd be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 all the way until you get to 35. Now you could certainly add that together. It'd take a couple minutes on your calculator. You could do it by hand if you wanted to. But also, you could just use that formula, which is n is 35 times 35 plus 1, which of course is 36, divided by 2, which would give me 35 times 36 divided by 2. Now I could cancel 36 and 2 to give me 18. So 35 times 18 would be the answer, which is 630, which is a whole lot easier than adding 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7. You get the point, all the way to 35, okay? And if you don't even know the value of your upper bound, then you certainly couldn't get a value, but you could use this formula rather than writing that out that many times, right? So that's how that formula works. So next on the agenda, number 3, is what if I were squared? And there's that formula. So again, I equals 1 to n. And again, what's happening in my Microsoft Word where I type this, or PowerPoint, because this font is small, I guess it refuses to put the I underneath and the N on top like it does if I use a bare font. I tried every way I could. I couldn't get it to do anything but out front. So don't let that bother you, though. That really means that the I equals 1 is underneath and the N is on top. And again, for I squared, so remember the rule is you plug in the lower limit first. 1 goes in for the I value, so it's 1 squared. Then the next integer, 2, goes in, and then 3 goes in, all the way till we get to the upper bound, which is just n in this case. So that's what I've got listed here. Now, really strange, but it turns out that there's a formula for that, and that is the formula. N times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6. Now, my plan is to do a proof of that problem. When I finish the 4 formulas, we're going to do a proof of that one. Then the method of proving works for 1, 2, and 4, but we're just going to do one of them because I don't think you have to see all 4 of them in a video. You could do the other 3 on your own, I have no doubt. But that's the formula, okay? And if I made this I equals 1 to 45, instead of writing out 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared all the way to 45 squared and adding that up in your calculator, then you could just plug it in this formula and it would tell you the exact sum. And then the 4th one, you probably guessed what that formula is going to represent. I equals 1 to n of I to the third. So 1 to the third plus 2 to the third plus 3 to the third, all the way till you get to the upper bound to the third power. And that formula is n squared times n plus 1 squared over 4. So now I promised you a proof of the third formula. So I'm going to show you something called a proof by induction. So here we go. We're going to prove that the sum of I equals 1 to n of I squared is equivalent to n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6. And we're going to do what's called a proof by induction. And a problem like this where you're trying to prove a formula, a proof by induction is often a good plan. Now, the strategy for a proof by induction is pretty straightforward. The first thing you have to do is you have to prove it's true for n is equal to 1. Okay, so let's write down what that means. So I have the sum of I equals 1 to 1, right? Because n is equal to 1 of I squared. So of 1 squared, I have to prove that's true, that my formula works. So my formula, if I plug in 1, right, n is 1, would be 1 times 1 plus 1 times 2 times 1 plus 1 divided by 6. I'm working on my formula side here. That's 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 times 1 is 2 plus 1 is 3 over 6. And 1 times 2 times 3 is 6 over 6. And my answer is 1. Now, is that the same thing? Like, if I do what this says, I equals 1 to n of, well, let's just write I squared there. And then I plug in 1, which would just be 1 squared, which just simply gives me 1. So that's true. We proved it was true for n equals 1. Now, step 2 is you assume, true for n is equal, it's an n, for n is equal to k. Okay, this is a weird step. You assume it's true for n equals k. So what I'm assuming is true is that the sum of I is equal to 1 to k of I squared is equal to k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 over 6. You see what I did there? All I did was change my n's to k's because it says assume this is true for n equals k. Now, if you're assuming something's true, the thought is you're probably going to use it somewhere. And we will, okay? We're supposed to when you do your proof by induction. Now, the third part of a proof by induction is to show it's true for n is equal to k plus 1. What? Right? Okay, so we're going to replace our n with k plus 1. So I go from I is equal 1 to k plus 1 of, not of, hold on, of I squared is equal to, now you could write it out, you know, that would be 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared all the way to k plus 1 squared. Okay? Let's write that out. So that would be, that's an I squared right there. 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared plus dot, 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 all the way to k plus 1 squared. But now tell me, what comes before k plus 1 squared? Well, wouldn't that be k squared? And then we would have k plus 1 squared. Am I right? So it'd be 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared plus all those in the middle plus k squared plus k plus 1 squared. You agree? Okay, now check this part out. This part right here, all the way to the k squared, is equal to k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 over 6. Is it not? Because that, we already assumed it's true. If we go from I equals 1 to k, then this is the formula. So I'm going to replace the 1 squared all the way to k squared with k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 over 6. Plus, and then extra, is this k plus 1 squared down here. Now our next move is to combine this together, but you see I'm completely running out of space. So what I'd like to do is get this prove true for n equals 1 out of the way. We've already done that, so let's get rid of that. We don't need it. And where for whatever reason my eraser is not working properly. There we go. All right, so erase away. Okay, now what I want you to be doing while I'm erasing is work on finding a common denominator so we can write that as one fraction, okay? You may be wondering what we're shooting for. I'm going to show you in a minute, but let's at least combine this together, okay? So I've got k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 plus k plus 1 squared. I need this over 6. So to get it over 6, I'm going to multiply this by 6 over 6. That'll do it, right? So we have k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1, and then plus k plus 1 squared times 6, all over 6. So that's where we are now. Now, you might want to think about where you're going at this point. You simplify, just like you would when you simplify a derivative and you want to factor out a greatest common factor. We're doing that. But let me tell you what the ultimate goal is. The ultimate goal is to show that everywhere there's an n in our formula, you can have a k plus 1. So imagine having a k plus 1 here, a k plus 1 here, and a k plus 1 right there. If we show that, then we showed that our formula is true for the next number in line. It's always true. Therefore, your formula is true for every value. And that's the method of a proof by induction. So here's what we're going to do. Don't stress over that. We're going to factor out a greatest common factor on top. You see what it is. It's k plus 1. So let's pull out that k plus 1. Okay. And that's going to leave me with, so if I pull that one out right there, it's going to leave me with k times 2k plus 1. Right here, if I pull out that k plus 1, one of them is going to stay, because remember that's squared, and that 6 is going to stay. I'm going to put the 6 in front, times k plus 1, and that's all divided by 6. Now, it looks like a nasty mess. It's okay. K plus 1 stays out front. As a matter of fact, you know what? That's great. That first n right here is supposed to turn into a k plus 1. That's it. Now let's see if we can get the rest of this part out of it. So I'm going to distribute, just like you would do if you had a derivative, you would distribute that k inside. So it's 2k squared plus k. Over here, that's going to be plus 6k plus 6. And don't forget that's over 6. I'm going to keep going and move up here, okay? Now I still have that k plus 1 out front. We're going to leave it because that's exactly what we need. And in the brackets, I have 2k squared. I'm going to add like terms. K plus 6k is 7k. And then plus 6. And that's divided by 6. Okay. Now this will factor. Okay. Do you see how to factor that? I have k plus 1. Okay. It's going to factor into k plus 2. Times, what else do we need? How about a 2k plus 3? So we just multiplies to be 6 and multiplies to be 2k squared and you work it out so it works out just fine over 6. Now believe it or not, that's what we need. So notice this n right here, that's my k plus 1. Well, how is this k plus 1 plus 1? Well, that is what k plus 2 is, right? So I have my k plus 1. And this k plus 2, I'm going to write it as k plus 1 plus 1. What about 2k plus 3? Okay, well, if I replace my n with k plus 1, that would be 2 times k plus 1. And then in the formula is plus 1. Now, is that not equivalent to 2k plus 3? That'd be 2k plus 2 plus 1 more. That is 2k plus 3 over 6. I'm going to highlight to show you again what we did. So this is our first n value. This is the next n value, and then this is the 2n plus 1, because the formula says n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6. Now, what in the world have we done? We have proven it by induction. This is the end of the proof. We showed it's true for k plus 1. So if I back up, remember where we started was, give my computer a second to do this. You have to prove it's true for n equals 1. So all we did was plug 1 into our formula, which was 1 squared on this side, which gave us 1, and then I plugged it into this formula, and then I also got 1. So we showed it's true for n equals 1. Then the green over here, the important step, you have to assume it's true for n equals k. So all I did was write my formula down with a k in it. I equals 1 to k of I squared, which is really 1 plus, well, I'm sorry, 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared all the way to k squared. Okay, that's what that is. And it's equivalent to k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 over 6. Now I've got to show it's true for k plus 1. And I wrote that out. And if we all go all the way to k plus 1, then the one less than that is k, okay? And then you use your assumption to replace the first 1 through k terms, which is k times k plus 1 times 2k plus 1 over 6, plus this guy out here, the brand new k plus 1 squared. And then we did the algebra on the next page to show that that is equivalent to this formula, which is k plus 1 plugged in. Okay, now I'm going to be honest with you. That's not the one that I meant to prove, even in this video. I was going to prove the second one. In the middle of doing this one, I realized, wait a minute, that's not the one I wanted to do, because the one we just did is a little more complicated. So what I'd love for you to try on your own is to prove the second one. It's actually much easier to do than the third one, or say the fourth one, but the methods are the same. So this is a proof by induction. It's a good introduction to just proving certain types of theorems, and it's neat. It's a neat little puzzle problem, but really in the end, I just need you to know these formulas and be able to use them. And we're not there yet. We haven't used them for the purpose that I'm showing you. Okay, so just keep them in mind as we move on along and learning about area. Okay, now before we finally talk about area, because again, nothing we've talked about in this video so far really directly relates to area that you're aware of anyway. It all directly relates to area, but you just haven't seen that yet. So I had to give you the skills of finding summation. I had to give you the formulas that you're going to need when you sum certain values together. And I proved one of those formulas. And now I want to talk about limits. Now, I know you know how to find limits at infinity, but to do some of these area problems, this is required. So this is just a review for you. This is nothing new right here that I'm about to show you. I just want to make sure you know how to do it before we jump into these area problems. So I'm asking you to find the limit as n goes to infinity of S sub n. Okay, now our S sub n in this particular case is 1 over n squared times n plus 1 over 2. So basically I could just write that out. The limit as n approaches infinity, okay, of 1 over n squared times n plus 1 over 2. So the question is, how would you calculate this limit? Now, it kind of helps to see the stuff multiplied out. You don't necessarily have to multiply it out, but I do think it's easier. This 1 times n, of course, is 1n, which is n, times n. I'm going to distribute. So 1n times n is n squared. 1n times 1 is plus n divided by, in the denominator, that's just 2n squared. Now, remember the rule for these. What you end up doing is multiplying, and this is only because it's going to infinity or negative infinity if we needed that, but these are just going to go to positive infinity, is 1 over your variable to the highest power. So in the numerator, I'm going to multiply 1 over n squared, because again, it's n squared is the highest power of the denominator, and I multiply the same thing in the denominator. That's how you do these, which is equivalent to, now I'm distribute, right? So that's going to be the limit as n approaches infinity of n squared over n squared plus n over n squared times 2n squared over n squared. So that results in, remember, n squared over n squared is 1. So I have the limit as n approaches infinity. I guess I wrote too big, didn't I? N squared over n squared is 1. Plus, now n over n squared reduces to 1 over n. We know what's going to happen to that, right? And then in the denominator, we just have 2. Now, whenever you go to infinity, remember the trick, and this is the whole reason, the entire reason we multiply by 1 over your variable to the highest power from the denominator. So we can use this rule that says when you go to infinity, or negative infinity, if the case were to be that, not when you're finding an area, it'll always be positive infinity, that 1 over n goes to 0. Because it's like you have a constant over infinity, which just gets smaller and smaller. So our answer to this limit is just the constants that are left, which is 1/2. Now, could you have seen that right off the bat? You sure could, right? When this gets multiplied out, notice it's an n squared on the top, and on the bottom, it's a 2n squared. And when you have degrees that match, it's leading coefficient over leading coefficient, and there's your 1/2 right there. Is it okay to do it that way? It is if you're confident about what you're doing. But the real thing you're supposed to be doing is taking the limit as n goes to infinity. Now again, you don't know why you need that yet. Okay, it's just some skills I want to make sure that you're completely aware of before we begin talking about area. Okay, now I'm going to come back and talk about area in the second video. So this is just the pre-area video. And now in the next video, we're going to come back and actually calculate some area.